Welcome back, everybody, to another episode of This My Bourbon Podcast. I'm your host, Perry. With me, as he always is, it's my co-host, Eric Smith.
Happy, happy, joy, joy.
Happy, happy, joy, joy.
Happy, happy, joy, joy.
Happy, happy, joy, joy.
Happy,
happy, joy, joy.
Happy, happy, joy, joy.
Happy, happy, joy, joy, joy. Diddle-dee-doo. That's two episodes in a row that we've opened up with singing.
Hey. Yeah. Why not?
I don't know, dude.
Why not, though?
We had a really couple of weird pregame stuff that we just got recording. It just kind of set the tone for the day.
Weird.
We haven't gotten weird in a while.
I feel good.
It's time to get weird together.
Let's get weird.
I'll tell you another reason why I feel weird. Last night, there was a storm that hit Lexington, Kentucky, and much worse out in western Kentucky. And we had gone over to mom and dad's for dinner, and the storm started like moving in, and it was moving fast too. I mean, fast and furious.
Tokyo Drift.
And we were in the basement at their house. We don't have a basement here at our place, and we're like, it's safer for us to be at their house and be in a basement and everything, because we got the baby and we didn't want anything to happen to her. When we were downstairs, we heard something fall. We heard something just fall over. We're like, oh, it's probably a trash can or the recycling bin or whatever. And it's just, it's fine. Go up to leave. We look out the front door. What we heard fall was one of their trees in their front yard. And it fell completely parallel to my car and my sister's car.
Ooh.
I mean, it was feet away from destroying her car. It was crazy. And so they got a tree removed.
She hadn't been reading books about fixing cars.
Yeah. I don't know why that made me laugh so much. But they had a tree removed before in their front yard. They had three originally. Got that one removed. This tree fell over, and it fell into the third tree that was in their front yard. And they have to get that one removed now, too.
Is this like dominoes right now?
It was crazy, man. Jeez. I mean, it knocked down like a significant portion of it to the point where like it was a big branch that fell and it made the tree lean. Like if we had had another storm like that, that other tree would have fallen as well. So, and like these were trees that were planted in the 1800s.
Lord of mercy.
I mean, because the land that they live on used to be the farms that Henry Clay owned. So it was trees planted when Henry Clay was alive. And they're gone.
Man.
So, sucks, right? It's crazy.
So that's Papa Ritter's trying to find somebody to get these trees pulled up and moved out, right?
They did it this morning.
Really?
Like,
he's on it, huh?
Yeah. They found out that the city does free tree removal.
Oh.
For like storm damage, stuff like that.
I was hoping that it would be like him outside, like your mom like pulls back the curtain. He's got his shirt off and he's just got an axe. And he's like, yeah. And she's like, "Damn, look at Papa Ritter right now."
The world's biggest saw, like in cartoons.
He like wipes the sweat from his brow and like he's like, "Yeah,
I didn't know you had Timberlands."
Where'd you get those? He went out and got everything like to be like make it official, and he's just like,
did you grow a beard overnight?
He grew a beard, everything, and he's
Papa
just
Papa Ritter.
Like, oh, Papa Ritter. Damn.
What a weird day this has been.
Yeah.
But anyway, if this is your first time listening to the show, we don't normally talk about trees.
Or Perry's dad
bourbon.
Shirtless. Yeah. And his mom looking out the window.
Going, okay.
Getting all sorts of feels. All
right. I hate this. Anyway, if you're listening to this for the first time, thank you so much for being here. You can go ahead and subscribe if you have not done so already. If you are returning because you just love the show so much and you have not yet done so, please leave us a 5-star rating and review in your podcast app of choice. If you're on Spotify, you can now leave us a 5-star rating. Apple, of course, you can still leave us a rating and review. We read out reviews here on the show. I haven't checked to see. It's only been 2 days since we recorded last, but I don't think we have any new reviews to nothing new this week. So sometime soon, but you can also follow us on social media at My Bourbon Pod on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter at Whiskey Mutant on Instagram.
That's me.
Mainly. You can find all of our apparel and merchandise at bourbonshop.threadless.com. You can buy tickets to our meetup weekend, our event. This is my bourbon weekend. I think we've just kind of fallen back onto that being the name for
it. That's the brand.
So, yeah. That is going to be Memorial Day weekend. That's Friday, Saturday, and Sunday pretty much is when the bulk of all that's happening. Saturday, we're going to be doing a live show with Chad from My Daily Bourbon and Jason from The Mash and Drum. You can find tickets for that at the Eventbrite link in the description of the episode below.
Click it.
We are almost sold out of the all-in tickets, which is crazy. I think we're going to have to add some hotel rooms too.
Yeah, we can do that anytime. We just need to, we got to figure out when our next meeting is.
Yeah. Jeez. We got a lot of stuff to do. Yeah. But you can also become a supporter of the show at patreon.com/mybourbonpodcast. Links for everything are also in the description of the episode. Little as a dollar a month helps us out. Little as $5 a month gets you bonus.
Weird stuff.
Weird content. Weird stuff. I don't know what to say about it. Anyway, this week's bonus stuff is bizarre. If you want to hear me spill vintage bourbon on myself,
yeah,
he can do so in the season finale of
and hear me find a sample bottle that I thought was going to be amazing and it's undrinkable.
Yeah,
we literally couldn't even pour it in our glass.
Nope. Anyway. I'm so thrown off by the weirdness of those two things that we just recorded.
All right.
Now we're back in it.
Back in the zone.
So we're starting out this week with Flying Blind.
Are we?
Well, I've got something I want to blind you with.
See, this was the part where I was going to go, you know what? I came prepared for everything. And I was going to say, let's play a game. And then I was going to say, hey, will you go back and edit the Ghostface from Scream saying that when I said that? Because I was like, I don't know if we need to do sips and snacks. So I brought us. I was going to give you the option, and then you throw out, I got something I want to blind you on. So now it's like just crazy.
I have something I really want to blind you.
Okay,
on.
Let's do. I was going to do sips and snacks, but then I had a blind that I wanted to blind you on, and
let's just blind each other.
Okay.
Then. So here's what I'm going to do. You give me a glass. I'll give you a glass. I'll pour for you what I have for you. And then you can pour for me what you have for me.
And then we drink them together.
And we drink them together. Here's yours. Pop-a-lop-a-ding-dong. That doesn't make any sense. I don't know why I said that.
I like it, though.
That's
pop-a-lop-a-ding-dong.
You know, I think I just need to go back to bed and start over again. Today is just a complete wash.
No, it's not, because we got double flying blind right now.
Double blind. Oh, double blind is what we call it when we blind each other.
Yes.
We got flying blind normally.
Sand.
Oh, no. I did it again. This is 2 weeks in a row. Sand.
Okay. That smells good.
I'm smelling the one that I poured for you first.
Oh, I haven't poured. Oh, shit.
Hold on.
Time out.
You didn't pour any for yourself?
No.
Well, I got to turn away again.
All right. So you... All right. We're starting with the one you poured for me.
Yes.
Right, okay. Oh, baby, that smells good.
I've got a story behind this one, too. Oh, okay. And there's a good reason that I wanted to blind you with this.
Okay, this nose, it smells older.
What are you thinking age-wise? Oh, man, it's so good.
12.
Okay.
It reminds me of Heaven Hill.
Okay.
But, oh, I don't know. It's kind of turkey-like, too. Okay, this is lower proof. I'm really thinking like high 80s, 90s. I normally, it's got a good like mouthfeel too. So that makes me think it's an older, lower proof bourbon.
You're on the right track. It's got a really good finish too.
I was going to say, the finish isn't like I hit you in the chest. I think I said this last time, too. It's more of like, it just lingers. Like, it's like, I could sip on this and not have to, like, keep going back for something.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I like that
a lot. It's, like, dangerous because it's lower proof.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it's and despite the fact that it's got, like, a lot going on, it's very crushable.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Because it's almost like a, it's almost like cotton candy, too. I get that kind of grape, older oak note, too. But I don't think it's really, 12 years old, 80s to 90s, possibly Heaven Hill or Turkey.
Okay.
That's what I'm saying.
90 proof.
Okay.
Just over 10 years.
Okay, yeah.
So you were pretty close.
Yeah.
It's from Buffalo Trace.
Oh, man. I was going to say Eagle Rare. Eagle Rare.
The grape. I say grape.
I know you did. And I was waiting
every time.
I was waiting for you to go, well, because I'm getting that grape, it's the Eagle Rare.
Yes.
So this is a pick that I helped kind of inspire in some ways, but I was not able to participate in because I was out of town at the time. This was done by our good friend Dexter.
Oh, I know which one this is.
In conjunction with
Dixon,
the Beaumont Inn.
I knew about this bottle.
He had texted me last year while we were on vacation, and asked if I wanted to go or if I could go. And I was like, dude, I'm going to be out of town that day. He was like, look, I tried. I was like, I know. But so, yeah, he and Dixon and Dexter's dad went too. I think some of his other family went.
Yeah, he was
went,
telling me about that whenever I picked up that Jefferson's pick from him.
But he sent me a message saying that he had something for me. And I was like, oh, what is this? What could he have for me? And it was a bottle of this. So the thing is, too, he's got a bunch left. Yeah. this is not my last bottle of this, I will say. But it's weird to have a bottle of something that I was so close in the inspiration for, but never actually got to participate in. You know what I mean?
Right.
This is one of the best Eagle Rare picks I've ever had. I mean, I'm just going to say it.
I mean, I thought it was an older turkey almost. Like,
yeah.
And my gut was saying Buffalo Trace and Purple and Eagle Rare, but like it just had this little bit. It was just a tad bit different for me to not be confident enough to say, hey, this is Eagle Rare or Buffalo Trace or something. Are you going to put it in that?
I think I found out what I'm going to do with this decanter.
It's a sign. Oh, dude, that's so good. Oh, and it's even more Eagle Rare-y now that I know what it is.
It's phenomenal. And I asked Dexter, too, because I thought I remembered seeing that it was mash bill 2.
Mm-hmm.
I asked if it was mash bill 2 when I picked it up from him. He said, no, if it had been, I would have been all over it. And
yeah,
you probably wouldn't have seen a bottle.
Yeah.
But it's incredible, it's so man.
Good. I'm going to save a little bit just for later.
Oh, I'm holding on to the rest of that as well. So I hope that what you poured for me lives up to what I just poured for you.
Well, you know what? I don't know because I've never had this. I literally just got it and opened it. Neither one of us have had this. Well, I'll explain later, but we've technically not had this before, so I don't even know what it tastes like.
Do I know what this is? Do we talk about this?
I don't know. I don't think we've ever mentioned
it. It's not what we talked about last night.
No, not yet. No.
For that we're actually going to do for the review.
I've got both of those for the review.
Okay, so this is something completely different.
This is I saw this morning leaving work at Ernie's, and I bought it because it was not going to hurt me if I didn't like it.
I like the nose.
Oh, wow.
Kind of citrusy.
Yeah, dude. It's like... it's like a lemon pound cake or something.
Yeah.
Whoa. It's a little dry.
It's very dry.
Is this older?
I don't know. Like, it does, it's not age stated. I don't know. Like, this will be a little segment at the end after I reveal this that me and you will probably sit here and try to figure out what this is. Because I have no clue.
I'm too curious. But
what's the proof you think on that? Dude, I like that. I like it. It's kind of bready.
Yeah, I want to say like 115.
It's 120, 1.5. So,
I was going back and forth between 115 and 120. It again is another one that reminds me a lot of Heaven Hill.
I mean,
but I said that last week and it turned out to be MGP. So,
okay. So, have you heard of Curly and Company?
No.
So this is Ernie's got
that's a Kentucky Owl bottle.
Yeah, they got this in and I had no idea what it was. I hadn't had time to research it. They got a small batch and then they got this is a single barrel. 121.5 proof. This is Curly and Co. Kentucky Straight Bourbon Whiskey.
What's the price?
Distilled and bottled in Kentucky. He gave me the frequent customer price. Yeah. I paid $60 for this.
Boy, I am buying one of those. I am going over there before
it's 75.
Don't care. Don't care. I am going and picking up one of those before I get my daughter from preschool.
EJ Curly and Co. And he didn't really know much about it. He said they got bottles and here's what the back says. After the Civil War, Irish-born soldier Edmund Curly sourced pure limestone filtered water from our natural cavern far below Earth's surface to produce one heck of a smooth drinking bourbon.
Your mom's a natural cavern.
Oh, shit. That's a good one. Our offering honors those who won their liberty at Camp Nelson, forging a more perfect union. Distilled in Kentucky, bottled by E.J. Curly and Co., Stanford, Kentucky.
Camp Nelson?
I mean, I don't know, dude. Look, I have no idea where it's from. I don't know.
Turkey?
I don't know anything. I don't know anything about it. And when he told me that he would give me the discount and it was going to be like $65 out the door, I was like, 121 proof Kentucky bourbon, 60 some dollars out the door. I said, I'm going to get it and I'm going to open it with Perry and see what we think. I have no idea what it is.
I don't think it's Barton.
No, it doesn't taste anything like Barton.
I can't get past the Fort Nelson thing or Camp Nelson.
I know.
Because now I'm starting to think turkey, but it doesn't remind me of turkey very much. Like even older turkey, it doesn't drink like this.
Right.
I want to say it's probably Heaven Hill.
See, that's what I was kind of thinking too when you said Heaven Hill. But.
Dude, I am 100% getting a bottle of this. I love the way it looks, too.
Yeah.
I think it's just a beautiful design.
It was on the back shelf where like all the new releases are that they put, and I had no idea about it.
That's just crazy. It's rare that I get blindsided with a product I've never heard of before.
Yeah, I don't know anything about it.
Because, I mean, you know, I see the TTB stuff just about daily. And, you know, if there's something new that people are, you know, excited about, they send it to me or whatever. Like, I am completely just thrown off by the fact that this is even a thing.
I have no idea.
But I'm already so on board with it.
Yeah.
I mean, it feels like... Doesn't it feel like a single barrel of Elijah Craig?
Yeah, it's something. Yeah, it reminds me of something like that.
It reminds me of old Elijah Craig. Like the ones that used to be in the pirate bottle.
Yeah.
Not necessarily like the barrel proof ones, like more towards the small batch 94 proof 12-year-old. Dude, it's so good though.
Yeah, I don't know what the small batch tastes like, but I saw the proof on the 121 and I was like,
what's the proof on the small batch?
I don't remember.
It doesn't matter. I'm not getting this.
Yeah. I don't know.
I'm not thinking twice about it.
Yeah, dude.
I'm a big, big fan of that. At that price, too.
Yeah.
That's astounding to me. That it's as affordable as it is.
Yeah, I was expecting him to be like one of those over $100 bottles. And I was going to be like, no, I'll pass on that. But when he was like, well, it's $75. I'll give you, you know, your little customer discount. I was like, okay, I'll take it.
It needs a cigar with it.
I wouldn't know anything about that, but I would grab a freaking fudge round right now eat it all over it. I don't know what that means. Eat it all over it. I mean, I would be all over it with a fudge round.
Eric, I know it's only been 2 days since we recorded, but I think we at least have a couple of things to talk about what we've been drinking recently.
Well, I think we can lead into talking about our new riff pick by talking about lunch we had before. And we stopped at Libby's in Covington and got some brunch, I guess you would say, brunch, lunch. And they have a great bourbon selection. And on Thursdays, you get half off of vintage.
Yeah, you do.
Pours. So, me and Embellish Pod.
Hi, John.
Hi, John. We tried some I.W. Harper, and it was, do you remember?
15?
15
yeah,
years?
15 years old.
It was magic. Like, I just sat and smelled it the whole time, almost. I was just like, this just smells like the creation of bourbon. Like, it was so good. And we actually ended up finishing the bottle. And yeah. Chad, my daily, kept the bottle because he's got some crazy plan for it. But
the old so-and-so.
Yeah. But I don't know, man. It's just so nice. It's so nice every once in a while when you've been used to... There's nothing wrong with... Like, we were getting ready for the new riff pick. I'd had a little bit of new riff before. You know, we'd been drinking a lot of MGP stuff, a lot of younger stuff. And it's just so nice to just sit down with something older like that.
Yeah.
Oh, I got to say, though, did I say what I had at Whiskey Weekend in my tasting when we spun the wheel?
Mm-mm. No, you didn't.
That was probably... Thinking of an older bourbon, but we spun the wheel, and Grease had acquired a bottle of Elijah Craig 18 International Release Pre-Fire.
That's right, yeah.
Distilled in 1979. Perry, I don't even know how to describe how good that was. It was nothing. Like, you hear Elijah Craig 18, you're like, oh, whatever. This was pre-fire Elijah Craig 18 from 1979, or it was distilled in 1979. And it was one of those things where you take a sip and you just sit back in your chair. There was room full of people. Everybody was trying it. And I felt like I was in my own, like...
It's like that scene in Ratatouille where he gets...
Yes!
It zooms into his eyeball, yeah. And he gets sent back to...
Yeah. Yeah, it was like I just saw, like, my birth and, like, me growing up and, like, discovering bourbon and, like, all this stuff happened. Like, no joke, it was just... I don't know. It was just, like...
Magical.
Magical. And it made me think, like, man, I wish that I had more stuff that, like, was, like, that legendary type deal.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you something that was not magical. On the opposite end of that spectrum,
into this,
was the Jim Beam bottle and bond decanter that Chad, my daily bourbon, and I finished off.
I can't say I beat him a lot, but like I feel like I won on
you that. Absolutely, yeah. Did. I mean, it was per pour, because it was half off Thursdays or whatever, Vintage Thursdays, I think is what they called it. It was only $12.50
yeah.
per pour.
It looked like a genie bottle.
It did. I mean, it's a really cool looking bottle.
And he's got it too.
Yeah. So he's got something he's going to do with those for the meetup. I would really rather, never mind it. We don't have to talk about it right now. but it was awful. It was just horrible. And it had clearly turned. It was cloudy when we got the pour.
You did them a favor.
We did them a favor by finishing it off. I mean, there were literally 2 ounces of it left, and Chad and I each had one. And I took a sip of it before Chad tried his. And I looked at him and essentially just kind of like gave him the universal sign for like, no, bad stuff. Not good.
He chugged it and chased it.
I chugged it as well. I took one like courtesy sip.
Well, me and John are over here just like
enjoying your IW
our nose Harper's down in the glass and just going to town on it.
So I took a sip, hated it, and then chugged the rest of it because I was like, you know what? What else? I'm not going to enjoy it if I like continue to sip on it. But it was rancid, man. I mean, it was real bad. But then after that, because it was our pick day and I was having a good time and I wanted to enjoy myself, I had their bourbon special of the week, which is 2 ounces of whatever their bourbon of the week is, and then a Miller High Life Pony. And it was Early Times Bottled and Bond, and it rekindled my love for that bourbon. Like, I've got it before they switch over to, you know, Buffalo Trace juice or Barton or whatever it is.
Yeah.
I've got to get a couple bottles just because it's that. It's that amazing. Yeah, I'll go there and get one of those, and I'm going to get one of the curlies.
Early Times.
Yeah. Heck yeah, dude. But I also just love Miller High Life.
It's champagne, right?
It's champagne and beers.
Yeah.
It's my beer of choice. It used to be PBR.
Who's your bear of choice?
My bear of choice? I was so blindsided by that question. My bear of choice. Probably Winnie the Pooh.
Okay.
He's
so lovable.
He is. It's either that or Yogi.
Yeah.
He's smarter than your average bear, you know?
That whole tie thing, though, man, just throws me off. He's trying to be a human.
Would you just rather he was completely naked?
Well, it's a tie. At least Pooh has a shirt on.
Yeah, but he's...
What's he trying to... He's not hiding anything. He might as well be naked.
It's a weird conversation.
Yeah, I don't know.
So, because we recorded just a couple of days ago, we don't have as much to cover as we normally do, but we're going to do our best to scrape from the bottom of the barrel, as it were. And
Do you know what I did see on Instagram?
What's that?
My Daily Bourbon shared the story about the news about Barton closing down their tours. Yeah, you're way late on that, My Daily Bourbon.
When did he post that?
This like, morning?
Today? Chad!
You're way late, bro. It's going to sound even better because this is going to be like a week later.
Oh, my gosh. Well, I'll tell you something that we can talk about is the San Francisco World Spirits Competition. Because there have been medals that have been awarded.
Who won?
Over the past few days. Quite a lot of people.
Really?
A lot of stuff we've had. Stuff we've had, stuff we've said that we would like to have. So, yeah, there's a lot of stuff to go over. Do you want to just talk about the Kentucky bourbons?
Just do the main ones. Like, I don't know even how you say that, but like, is there like a freaking champion of everything?
Well, they do...
over 10 years or single barrel or something like that?
They do just by like quality.
Right.
I think is the way that they technically... do that. There is some really significant stuff to
anything
talk about.
You see that's significant, just throw it out there.
Pursuit United Batch 2 got silver. Discovery Series 6 got double gold.
Hmm.
1790, like I said, Barton really struck gold. Mm-hmm. Here. They're bottled in bond, foolproof, and sweet wheat all got double gold.
Dude, I'm not a fan of their sweet wheat.
A lot of people love it.
I don't. I have a bottle. It's not, maybe I need to revisit it. I'll bring it over.
We'll yeah, we should. It. We definitely should. Barrel bourbon batch 30 got double gold, but 32 got silver?
Was 32 the last one we tried?
32 is the one that we were just in love with. Hang on.
These judges.
Hang on. That's 28.
Oh, 30?
30.
There's 30.
Let's do it. I'm curious now because I don't know if I agree with you, San Francisco Spirits Competition.
Call it Fred Minute.
World Spirits?
Call it Fred.
All okay, right. 30 does smell amazing.
Oh, yeah, that smells pretty good.
Yeah. Okay, maybe I do agree with them.
Yeah, that's pretty good. I don't know if I like the finish that much, though.
Oh. Oh. Oh, I do love 30. 32, though, has a more, like, limited edition bourbon quality to it.
I think I like 32 more.
I think I do, too.
I like the finish on 32 way more than the finish on 30.
I agree. Benchmark Bonded. Got a double gold?
Well, that's nice. Good job, Benchmark.
Blue Note got a couple of golds. Double of golds.
Hey, that single barrel we had a Blue Note was really good.
That's very true. Taylor's single barrel got double gold. Like, of course it did.
It better. You put each single barrel into a competition, it better get something. Yeah.
Elijah Craig small batch double gold, but barrel proof A122 silver.
Hmm.
Interesting. The new 1783 from Evan Williams got double gold. There's a lot of stuff on here. I'm sorry. small batch select, from Four Roses got double gold. Regular Jim Beam got double.
I like that.
Interesting. All right. Here's where
I can't wait.
Here's something that I completely not only do not understand, but disagree with. Kentucky Al Wiseman got double gold.
In the poop category?
Are you 12?
Sorry. I couldn't think of anything else.
That's really funny that was what you went for. And then their rye, the Wiseman rye, got single gold.
I mean, I will not comment on that because I haven't tried.
Yeah, I mean, like, I imagine that I'm going to like that rye better than the bourbon. Bunch of golds for New Riff.
That's good.
Oh, man. Thomas Swanmore Chardonnay finish.
Oh, Swan Chardonnay.
Swan Chardonnay finished. Double gold.
Oh, I will agree because
I have been saying forever that product is the best one that came out in that original trio.
Out of all the ones you let me try, that Chardonnay was my favorite one.
Okay, Weller racked it up, too. Weller single barrel, double gold. William LaRue Weller, double gold. Antique 107, double gold. 12-year-old, double gold. Man. And Woodford's double oak got double gold. About that.
Let's go back to Weller.
Okay. That's fine. I get it. I quit, but I get it. Yeah, I mean it's one of those things that I know that a lot of people like to tout or talk about with the their prizes and their awards and everything. But the thing is, like, I mean, does it make any difference to you if a bottle has won a gold or a double gold?
It doesn't make a difference to me. I don't know how that makes a difference to maybe somebody who is not into it as much as us.
Yeah.
Like, if you're at Total Wine or you're at Liquor Barn or somewhere and you see that gold medal on there and you don't know what you're looking for, that's a good way to get somebody to grab your bottle. But
I tell you what I'm going to do.
I'm going to do it.
Okay. So I just put a poll up on Instagram, and by the time this episode comes out, it's gonna be over.
Yeah.
But we'll probably
talk about it.
Yeah. We'll at least mention it by the end of the episode.
Yeah.
But I asked, does it matter to you, or are you influenced by products winning medals at the San Francisco, or just in general?
In general.
So, you know, and you know, people can still let us know how they feel about it one way or another. I mean, please shoot us a message, comment on the thing.
Yeah, post it in the Facebook group.
Yeah, let us know. Because, I am genuinely curious. Because I do think that we are a little bit too close to the story.
Yeah.
To actually have, like, a good take on this. Or at least a take that is a little bit more neutral. And you know, we try so many things that it becomes hard for us to be like...
And we're always like, you know, everybody's palate's different, you know?
Yeah, exactly.
Who knows what they were tasting? You know.
Yeah, for sure. So, overall, an interesting spread for this year's...
San Francisco. When Foot Cock get?
Well, it's not out yet.
Oh, yeah. Sorry.
So, yeah, the 1 foot cock's not emerged.
Okay.
Just yet.
Yeah. It peaks at certain hours.
It does. It's true.
Yeah.
The bottles from Maker's Mark for this year's Derby, or excuse me, for Keeneland, are out and about right now too. They are really, really pretty. I don't know if you've seen them or not.
I haven't seen the new ones.
I'm gonna shoot it over to you real quick. They're like completely, so they've got their normal like wax strip. But they're also like completely covered in this like bronze paint as well.
Oh, I like that.
Yeah, they look really, really good.
Oh, I like that black waxed one.
I do too.
Oh, that's really nice.
I really like the black waxed one. I think that we're a little bit late on talking about this, but at the very least, like as a collector's piece. And the thing is, like, I know that a lot of people, and we've even said this before on the podcast, say that, you know, why would you spend that much money on a bottle of bourbon that you're never going to drink? This would be like one of the few times.
Like
if it's, at least pretty. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean, like, if I buy a piece of art, I'm still going to like display it and, you know, show it off for everybody. But you can still get some good whiskey out of it. But, you know, just to keep everything intact.
Just buy that bottle. And then turn around and just buy a regular bottle of Maker's Mark and enjoy that.
Yeah.
And then make a cool shelf all your display.
Yeah, it's not like you're not already spending a pretty good amount of money to pick up this bottle. What's $30 extra?
Right.
You know? They're really, really good looking bottles.
Yeah,
I mean,
really
the labels on them are... It looks like it's based off of, like, hand-painted images. I kind of wish that I had gotten one of these just to...
I feel like if I would have started early collecting those, that I would have just not stopped.
Yeah.
I would have kept going, especially the Kentucky Wildcat bottles and stuff like
that. Yeah. All right. We need to talk about this because I think it's something that we... It's not unimportant to the things that we typically like to cover or talk about on the podcast. I say like to talk about. I don't like talking about this, but I think it's important for us to discuss it. Diageo is being sued by a former blender at Bulleit.
A former blender.
Former blender. Okay. Eboni Major is her name. And she created Blender Select.
Okay. Oh, yeah, I have that. That's really good.
I love Blender Select. It's hands down my favorite product that came from Bulleit. And it's really unfortunate. I don't normally be like, trigger warning. But look, if you're uncomfortable with conversations about, you know, racial disparity and sexism and stuff like that, this might not be the story for you. Jump ahead a few minutes. But so this was published in the New York Times by our buddy Clay Risen, who we interviewed not too long ago. And directly from his article, it says, Miss Major, who is 31, was already in mediation, with Diageo, and would leave a few months later. In fact, she alleges in a lawsuit filed on Friday, long before the debut of Blender Select, she was the subject of persistent racial hostility, including pay discrepancies and demeaning treatment by coworkers. When she took her concerns to her bosses, she said in an interview, she was met with indifference and over time calculated efforts by the company to isolate her and eventually push her out. So here's the thing that, like, I think is the most important topic of discussion with this, despite the fact that this is wrong. And I think that, and look, I just did a pick with Bulleit.
Yeah.
But every time that I do anything with Bulleit, or any time I like talk about their product, I am constantly reminded of the fact that there is so much controversy around them.
Exactly.
There is so much issue that people have with them. And it's really unfortunate because I want to like them, but they're constantly giving me reasons not to.
Yeah.
But so in the thing that we need to be aware of, I think, at least in this space, is two things. One, we say that bourbon is inclusive, but it's not always shown that way, especially at a corporate level.
Yeah.
I mean, our community, I think, of bourbon drinkers and consumers is really, really good. And I think that we have gotten to a good place where we have all accepted the fact that we don't come from the same walks of life, and that we can be united by bourbon. But like there's that aspect of it, but also that I hate talking about this, but there is still this underlying element of our community doesn't know, and the people who like influence our community don't know how to accept people of color.
It's true.
You know, and I mean, that's way beyond just bourbon.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's that's a greater discussion that I don't think we're in the appropriate place to comment on. But it's, man, I hate seeing this. You know, like I felt like finally we were kind of getting past everything with Bulleit, and we were just kind of like, you know, the dues have been paid and the debts have been written off and everything. And now we've got this. Now we've got this again. And I just don't know. Like, what more do we have to do? How much further do we have to keep going? Like, is it just going to be something that we have
to... We need to go forward.
I know we... No.
That's the thing you said. Yeah. We need to go forward.
No, I know backwards. We do, but like... is this just something that we have to accept as like part of the story of bourbon?
We shouldn't have
right
to
now?
Accept that. No.
No, I know. I agree, but I'm just saying, like, you know, I just hate this so much. Like, I don't want to be talking about this. I don't want this to be the focus of, like, you know, bourbon's fun and we're, you know, a great community and la 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 la. But the thing is, like, there is a seedy underbelly.
Mm-hmm.
To a lot of what we get into. I mean, like, even the history of, like, Jack Daniels, which, you know, of course, it's bourbon. But, but like, that was built off the backs of, you know, slaves. Mm-hmm. And people who were slave owners and, you know, Uncle Nearest.
Yeah.
Which actually is, you know, the guy who taught like Jack Daniels how to distill and whatnot. And
we're in an age now where this information is easily available. Like, it's not something that you can just say you don't know because you don't have the means to it. Like, you can do research. You can see this. Like, it's there.
Yeah.
So.
It's just, it's really sad. It's really unfortunate. Yeah. And I think that you're right. We do have so much further to go.
Yeah.
And the article, I'm going to share the article link in the description of the episode as well.
And I got one more thing to add to that because I was scrolling through earlier on Instagram and my buddy Frank, Burb Your Enthusiasm on Instagram, he is doing a live chat with her
Dude, my first thought was we should get her on the podcast.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm deadly serious about it.
Yeah.
That we should talk to her and we should give her the opportunity to, you know, share her side of the story.
By the time this comes out, go to Burb Your Enthusiasm on Instagram and Frank will have done a live chat with her about this subject. And you can watch it on replay because he puts all his stories and his interviews on replay. So yeah. I would check that out. Burb Your Enthusiasm.
Yeah. Over the next couple of weeks, we're gonna work on getting her on the show because I think that that's something. I don't know. We've touched on it. I think that it's something that we've always kind of underlyingly had like as a part of our narrative of the podcast as well. But I think it's, you know, important that we give her the opportunity to, you know, speak out and everything. But like I said, the article is in the description of the episode. So go and check that out. Read it for yourself. But we are, it sucks, man.
It does.
It does a lot. We got a few TTB labels that we're going to be talking about before we move on to our review. The new Bardstown Discovery Series. It's Discovery Series 8.
I was going to say 8. I was going to say 7.
Yeah. I don't think I've had 7.
I don't think I've had much since like 4 or 5.
I've got, and I didn't know this until I was at Bardstown not too long ago, but they have airplane bottles of some of the Discovery Series and Fusion as well. So I got 4 and 6. And we haven't had the chance to like do anything with that just yet, but we will try to do so.
Can I be honest? I'm not a big fan of Fusion.
See, I'm the opposite. I like Fusion more than I do Discovery.
Ooh.
Because, and it's mostly because of the intrigue behind like what they can do with their own product. Mm-hmm. Like Discovery is basically them just sourcing other product and blending it together. Which everybody does.
Uh-huh.
But with Fusion, you're getting their own distillate.
Yeah.
And they're actually trying to figure out ways to like make it work, even if it's not in its own capacity.
No, I get it. Normal I'm just capacity. Saying, like, I just have yet to find. I've got like 2 bottles of the first couple of Fusions, and then I've tried a few of the newer ones. And I'm not saying they're bad. I've just not been a big fan of them.
Watch out, Perry. Watch out. Almost had another disaster. This is Fusion 3.
Okay.
And that was 2019 or 2020, I think. I can't remember. But I mean, I put it in like either my honorable mentions or like very, you know, it was at like number 10 or number 9 on my best of list.
See, I love the nose.
Yeah.
I mean,
I'm not trying to like convince you.
No. I'm trying to say what I'm saying about it. It's just like, I don't know. I would rather save up another 2 weeks by the Discovery than take the $60 or $70. And
that's fair.
I don't know. I think. Maybe I need to try one of the newer ones where their product is aged a little bit more. Because I still get, they put, this one is 13-year Kentucky, 3-year wheated, and 3-year rye bourbon from Bardstown. And I still, it just tastes a little grainy to me.
Yeah.
But that was just me saying, like, I'm how I am.
Yeah. I completely understand. I get it. I just think that, like, as far as experimental things go...
Well, that's more of their... that's getting closer to what you could just say this is straight up just Bardstown Bourbon Company.
Yeah. And I am excited for when we just have Bardstown Bourbon Company bourbon.
Yeah.
Like, just straight up their own
And you're
stuff.
Not automatically turning to the side and going, what exactly is in this?
Yeah. And I mean, like, it'd be cool if they still put, like, you know, all the mash bills and everything that went into it and how old it was and everything. But, you know, I am looking forward to when it is not, you know, 40% 13-year sourced bourbon.
Yeah. No, I get it. I
want it to be Bardstown Bourbon Company's product. But anyway, Discovery Series 8. It's coming in at 114.1 proof. It's not a bourbon. It is blended whiskey.
Okay.
66% Kentucky, 12-year-old, Heaven Hill juice. 17% Indiana, 7-year MGP bourbon, looks like. 11% Canadian corn whiskey.
Oh.
12 years old from Ontario.
Okay.
And 6% Indiana 6-year 95.5 rye.
Damn.
Yeah. Crazy stuff, right? I mean, I'm excited to try it. I'm curious. Like, right. You know, this is not something that they are...
That's an interesting lineup, I guess.
Yeah, it is. It really is. But I'm not put off by it.
Yeah.
I gots to know.
Gots to know.
Have you seen the... There have been these, like, bottles that have come out. They're called, like, the Senator or the...
Yes.
Yeah,
yes,
so there's one called that's coming out called the Cabinet from the same brand. I think it's really hard to tell, but I think it's from Proof and Wood is the name of the company that's making it. And it's a blend of rye and bourbon.
Okay.
Bottled this year. Looks like it's going to be 110 proof. I'm not entirely sure if that's accurate because the way that it's scribbled onto the label is really funny looking. But they've gone so far as to include like everything that's gone into it. 2013 rye, 9 years. Another 2013 rye, that's 9 years. 2014 rye, aged at least 7 years. 2015 rye, aged at least 6 years. And a 2017 bourbon, aged at least 4 years. The rye is 95.5, and the bourbon is 75% corn, 21% rye, 4% barley. I have not tried any of these yet.
I haven't had any either.
I've heard pretty good things about it, though. Like, nothing that's been like, oh, you don't drink this. It's,
right.
You know, rocket or whatever. But I don't know. It's interesting that they're doing all this. Healing Station has a new product coming out from what they're calling their vintage series. It's going to be 8 years old and 100 proof. It's got a nice little orange label. But be on the lookout for that. 52% corn, 44%, 44% rye.
Oh, wow.
My goodness. 4% malted barley. Rye. That's the highest rye I think I've ever seen. Yeah, I'm interested in it. I think Healing Station has been pretty good.
The single barrels I've had have been really good.
Yeah. And then last but not least, Remus has a new product coming out that's called Gatsby Reserve.
I saw somebody post that in our group chat.
Yeah.
I didn't look into it or see what it was about.
Yeah. 15 years old, 115 proof. I got to get one.
That sounds good.
I've got to get one.
You say 15 years?
15 years.
Is that just the MGP, 15-year MGP?
I am looking right now.
Because if it is... yes, we will definitely need to get one.
Yes, it is MGP.
So 15-year MGP.
Sorry, it's not MGP. It's Ross and Squibb.
It's Squidward and Patrick.
No, it's Ross from Friends and Squidward.
Oh, Ross and Squidward. Got it. But seriously, 15-year MGP?
Yeah. It's not... Why am I still holding this bottle? It's not like MGP at that age is typically, you know, very, very affordable. I mean, 15 years, it's probably going to wind up being like 150, 160,
close to
something
200,
like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I mean, I'll split it with
you. What was the proof?
115.
I'll take it.
Yeah, for sure. Faux show. You want to get into our review?
Sure.
We got, here's, okay. I want to preface this by saying one thing and one thing only. We cannot talk about the look of the bottle. Does that make sense?
Okay.
Because literally everybody else that has done a review of this has said, well, the packaging's nice, though.
I mean, it looks less like the rye bottle.
So we are going to be reviewing batches 1 and 2 of Castle & Key's first bourbons. You all right?
No, he had it in a One of those airplane things.
Shipping things.
So the batch one is a completely new bottle, and batch two has been poured into a sample bottle.
Yeah.
So.
I am, despite the fact that we have been a little bit disparaging of the...
That cork is heavy. Jesus.
That cork just yeeted itself. Despite the fact that like we've talked pretty poorly about this, or you know, the thing is, we haven't had this before. And I in some ways am like really excited to try it. Just because of how long it's been that we've been like, oh, Cass, like, we gotta know what their bourbon's gonna be like, and it's steeped in all this history and everything. And you know, do I have high hopes for it? Not really, but I'm still looking forward to getting the chance to try it. Do you want to go ahead and pour one and two next to each other?
I can, yeah. But I mean, I think it's fine. I mean, I think it's perfectly fine for us to say what we think on paper and then try it and say what we think once we try it. Like, there's nothing wrong with that.
No, and I think that somebody was... We talked about it after... Like, we did that episode where we said, this is the problem with Castle & Key's first bourbon. And then we had a little bit of backlash to it. And people were like, oh, you haven't even tried it yet. And I can't believe you're not even excited for it. And I was like... No, we are excited for it. Like, we want to know what this is. We want to have a positive reaction to it.
It's like if a video game comes out and the trailer or the description makes you not excited about it.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not going to be like, you know what? Even though that sounds bad, this is going to be good.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, we're excited to try it because of our curiosity, but we don't have to be immediately excited because of what was written up doesn't, I don't even make us excited for it. Like, that's just how it is.
I almost said what I wasn't going to say. 98 proof. I think batch two is also 98 proof.
I think that is. Yeah. I think
that is. And they're both 4 years old.
I'm going to say one thing.
Okay.
It's too much.
You think it is?
I think so. I think it's too much. I don't know. I would prefer something simpler. That's all I'm gonna say.
That's fair.
Okay.
Okay. You know, I gotta be honest with you, I don't hate the nose.
I don't hate it either. I don't
what? You don't hate it either.
No, I'm trying to nose and talk.
I know, I'm sorry.
No, don't be sorry. I'm just saying, like, part of me likes it, and part of me is...
Wanting something more.
Wanting something more.
Yeah. But it has this nice, like, crisp honeycomb.
I was going to say a Honeycrisp apple.
Yeah.
It's very, very fruity. Leaning toward apple to me.
I really don't hate this.
The more I smell it, the more I like it.
Yeah.
I like the nose better. Right off the bat, I was a little taken back by it. It was a little off to me. But the finish is better.
I'm not ready to comment yet, interestingly enough.
Those were my initial reactions.
I need to sit with it for a second. Okay. I'm going to take another sip before I say anything.
If this tasted like the nose, I would be way more happy. I don't hate it. I can't say that it's bad. There's just something off about it to me. It's like a really good cherry Coke, but it's flat to me. Like, you know it's got potential, but it's just, there's something like holding it back.
Well, let me just say this. It is missing some darker notes that I would really like. Darker fruits, more barrel influence, I would say. It is quite sweet. It's got a lot of like heat, despite the fact that it's 98 proof. I like it though. I'm leaning towards really, really liking it. I enjoy the heck out of this. And part of it is probably because I went in with such low expectations.
Yeah. It just tastes flat to me.
That's interesting because I feel like I'm just getting more from it than you are.
I guess. I mean,
I'm just saying,
whatever.
I feel like it's almost like there's a cap, and it's just, I smell it and I'm like, this has the potential to be good. And then I taste it and I'm like, it's good, but like, there's something about it that's just holding it back.
Yeah.
Like, it's just flat.
I totally get that. I went back for a third sip.
And maybe
I'm coming back a little bit off of it, but I still don't. Here's the thing. This doesn't taste like anything else that's on the market.
No.
I think if nothing else, they have created a distinct flavor profile for themselves. This is probably going to be better at a higher proof.
I was going to say, maybe even at a single barrel. Maybe it's the proof that's getting me. I don't know.
Yeah, the finish is a little wonky. It's not my favorite thing, but I truly do not hate it.
Well, I guess we'll do our rating, but like, I mean, what is this? $55?
Something like, yeah, $55, $60.
I'm not mad at that at all. But I just feel like there's something holding it back. I want more.
Yeah.
This was batch one. We've obviously got batch two.
It's kind of corny. Like it's kind of like unbuttered popcorn. You know what I mean?
I'm sure we can look it up. What's the mash bill on this? Is it the same as the Blue Run? It's not.
No,
is it?
No.
The Blue Run's a higher.
Yeah. This mash bill should be. It should be identical to what the original Taylor bourbon was.
Man, it kind of pisses me off because it really does because. Yeah, I can taste the potential in this, and maybe that's me just being picky, and I'm not normally that picky, but I don't know, like, the hype and the anticipation for this, like, I feel like this has all the potential, and there's just something, like, capping it, and I don't know if it's the proof, I don't know if it needs another year, I don't know.
Okay, so there are three... There's three recipes that they make. One, of course, is their rye, which we're not worried about right now.
Yeah.
The other one, 73% corn, 17% malted barley, and either 10% rye or wheat.
Do we know what's in this?
Or
did they blend them?
I don't know.
I will say that's what I liked about the Blue Run is...
the high rye.
Well, they legit told us what the mash bill was right on the bottle.
Yeah.
It says it on there.
Batch 2 is 99 proof.
Okay.
Not 98.
All right.
Again, it just feels like a middle finger towards the legacy of E.H. Taylor. From the Castle & Key website, it does say that these are rye bourbons.
Okay. God, the nose is completely different.
Maybe this is. Whoa! No, it is.
Okay, I'm making sure. It is. It's completely different. And tell me, like, I texted you earlier about we were going to try to do one and two, like, and you said they put these out because I was clueless about it. I didn't know they put both of them out close together,
like,
right?
At the same time, essentially. Even though I think that initially what they wanted to do was batch one was going to come out in the spring and batch two was going to come out in the fall,
right?
But I think that the demand was so high for the bourbon at all that they just had to put out one and two at the same time.
Yeah.
You know, or very, very, very close to each other.
Dang.
That's
so
like
different.
Night and day, dude. The nose on batch one is like straight cigar tobacco. But batch two's got this like fruitcake thing about it.
You hit it on the head. There is this bread and fruit, and it's very Christmassy. It's like a Christmas cake. It is. I'm trying to reset everything. And it's fruitcake. It's fruitcake on the nose. You nailed it. This is messing with me. This is a mind fuck right now. Because why are the noses so much better than the palates on this? Do you think so? Did you like the palate on two better, or did you like the...
I'm sorry. I'm really thrown off by this.
I'm telling you, yeah, it's a mind if.
Oh, man.
I think I'm more concerned that the differences between one and two are so different that to the average drinker, you couldn't go in, and if these were on the shelf, you couldn't go in and be like, I want that Castle and Key bourbon because I like it. If you was to come upon batch two versus batch one, you would be completely thrown off if you poured it. If you like batch one, I don't know if you're going to like batch two.
I don't like batch two.
Batch two is way different.
It's
and
astringent?
It's not in a good way.
No. I think it almost lends itself a little bit towards being like bitter.
Yeah, I don't like that at all. Like,
oh, it's...
You still have batch one?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean,
it's like I'm having like a good physical reaction to the way that this goes.
I'm having just...
Oh, shit. You know what we didn't do? We didn't talk about our pick at New Riff. Yeah, it's fine.
It's a great pick.
It's a really good pick. I'm sorry if anybody missed out on it, but...
Basically, the main thing is we were all in agreeance that it came down to two, and if you had, we wanted both of them, because one was if you took the regular New Riff and just amped it up a bit,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
It would be amazing. And then the one we chose was if you took a New Riff single barrel, and it was like this, like amped up single barrel, a little bit different, you would want it too. And we picked that one. But the fact is, we all came down to two.
Like the exact same two.
Yeah, we narrowed it down from five down to two, and we all had the same two. God, going back to batch one, God, it's so much better than batch two. So much better.
Yeah, I don't disagree. But, in a vacuum, though, batch one is still just okay. Like, my initial reaction to it has very much been squashed. Like, I don't think it's as good as I thought it was initially. You know what I mean?
Yeah, no. Yeah, it's like batch one, not bad.
I could drink batch one.
I could drink batch one. If I have batch one and two side by side, I'm not drinking batch two at all.
Like, I don't even want to go back and drink batch two again.
I mean, oh, and thanks to Bluegrass Hole.
Chris Havens,
friend of the show. He gave us a sample of batch two, and he acquired the batch one bottle for me, and I got from him. So he's helped us out a lot. He's part of the Lexington Bourbon Society.
Yeah.
Sorry. But yeah, thanks for that. But man, I don't know. Side by side, batch one all day.
And even then, I mean, it's just not great. I want it to be. I really want it to be great. But I'm just kind of okay with it. You know?
Yeah.
Ah, batch two. Like, I have less than half an ounce in my glass of batch two. And I still am like, I don't want to go back and drink that.
No.
Oh, it's like asparagus. It's got like a weird root kind of vegetable flavor to it. It tastes dirty.
It's almost like, yeah. Yeah, you're exactly right. It's like freaking, I love rhubarb notes, but it's like.
This is bad rhubarb.
It's like the rhubarb is overshadowed by dirt.
I've got all this tension in my back now.
Perry's pissed right now. So mad.
I don't want to be. But this is a very broken bourbon.
Well,
you know what I mean? Like, it just doesn't have the unity that it should.
I'm kind of mad because...
And I take back what I said earlier about it being, you know, their own flavor profile. Because I don't think they've figured that out yet.
I'm more upset because batch one and two are so different.
Yeah.
Because... Let's
they shouldn't be.
Let's be honest. People around us right now in Lexington that aren't as into bourbon, they went for this. Like, this was a big deal to them. Like, this was announced on the news here. This was put out everywhere. And you got batch one. Yeah, it's pretty good. And then if you were like, I want to get another bottle, and you went and got batch two, you're going to be... I mean, maybe you won't. All our palettes are different, but like batch one and two are completely different and not in a good way.
Yeah.
So there we are.
It's just like we still need to do our
numbers
and everything for it, but let's just go batch by batch because I am going to get confused if I throw out too many numbers.
Batch one.
Batch one. Nose. Two. I'm giving it a two.
I'm three. When I smelled this, I really liked it. So my initial reaction is three. I was okay with the nose.
I don't know. Going back to it more, the nose is just kind of weird to me.
I'm still okay with it. I think it's like this kind of cherry caramel apple thing, but I'm okay with it.
Palette, I'm going 2.5.
Two. I wanted the nose to be more like the palette, and it wasn't.
The finish is probably the best part of this. Even then, it's not, like, blowing me away. I gotta give it a three.
I said 2.5. It was okay. Wasn't much there, but...
Yeah.
It was all right. I don't know.
Let's talk about the price before we, like, give our scores.
Okay.
So, it is $60-ish.
Mm-hmm.
I can't decide whether or not I want to give... both of them the same score on price because of what they are, or if I want to go base like product by product, batch by batch.
I will probably give them both the same.
I think price. I probably will as well. Look, it's really cool that this historic distillery has been revived and there's a new product out from it that came about because there was a passion to, you know, show up and show out with this historical place. I wish that the product was better that actually went into the bottle. But that being said, I think that it's still a collector's piece. And truth be told, this might not be for me. I think it could be for plenty of other people. This will probably age pretty well. Also, like, you know, if and when this becomes like a dusty bourbon, I could see this being something that people think is quite good by that time, like 50, 60 years from now.
That's a long fucking time.
But I'm just saying, like, I mean, I'm like 50 years ago was when, you know, the 1970s turkey that we love so much.
That's true.
Was around. And I mean, like,
how old was that, though?
Like 8 to 12 years. I mean, that's fair. That's totally fair. Sure. But I just, like, looking into the future of this product, I don't see people, you know, coming back to it eventually and being like, I don't know about this. Like, I think that it's going to be colored a little bit by the fact that it is a kind of a, like, bourbon cultural touchstone. So I don't dislike the price on it. I just wish the product inside was better. All in all, I think the price is a 4.
Okay. I gave it a 2.5.
No, that's fine. That's fine. It's just...
Like, I gave it right down... Okay. I gave it right down the middle. Out of 5, 2.5, whatever.
Yeah.
I gave it right down the middle because it's affordable. It's a good way to take a chance, but I don't know. Like, I feel like once I took a chance, like, I'm not as pleased with what I paid for it.
Yeah.
But I'm at 12.5.
I'm at 11.5. I don't know how you came out higher.
Did I do the math wrong on that? Lord, I don't know. I don't know what I did.
It's not that this is a, like, straight up recommend for me. I do think, though, that if you see it, pick up a bottle. I don't like that I'm being so contradictory, but I do think that this is an important piece of bourbon history that I think we are being witness to right now. Does that make sense?
Yes. It does. I think it's...
I hate that I'm justifying so much of this.
It is, because it's the first bourbon to come out of Castle Key in how long? Like the original...
I don't know. I don't remember exactly, but...
You're right. It's worth picking up just to see how you feel about it.
Yeah.
Because it's just us thinking what we feel about it. You could like it. But if you don't, sit it there and... Like Perry said, 50 years down the road, you've got
to... I hate to be that
but
way.
You've got a piece of history. Like, you really do.
Yeah, and I'm not saying that, like, you know, hold on to it for 50 years and then see what you think about it by the time that, you know, you're in your twilight years. But but I think that...
84 years ago.
But, like, you know, the 20 and 30-somethings in 2070... You know, they might see this, like, see an original bottle of this and be like... Well,
if they keep going, it would be cool to be like, here's the first batch of Castle.
Exactly.
Here's the 20th batch or whatever.
By that time, they're, like, injecting bourbon directly into your brain because that's the technology of the time.
Yeah, you go to the liquor store and, like, here's your computer chip.
But I don't think that it's a bad thing to have around. I am happy that we have a bottle. Now
we do.
And I gotta be honest with you, the only time I think I'm gonna pour any more of it out is just to kind of show people what it's like. But I'm not,
I mean, we got plenty of empty bottles. I'm gonna pour you plenty.
give me half of that.
Yeah half of that is going to you right now.
Yeah, that's fine. Batch two, though. I like the nose a lot on batch two. I'm gonna give it a 3.5.
I'm gonna give it a 3. I like the nose. I'm giving the palate a two. I absolutely do not like the palate on this. It's not the worst thing I've ever had, so I can't give it a zero or a one. But compared to batch one, it's not good. It's not good at all. Like,
I'm sorry. I'm giving the palate a 1.5.
Okay.
I don't like it. Mm-hmm. I don't. I think it's hard. It's kind of hard to drink. I think the finish brings it back up a little bit. Starts getting kind of. You don't like the finish? Mm-mm. I think it starts getting kind of like an Orange Julius. Like citrusy and vanilla-y, and like I like it at that point, but at the same time, like, I'm going a little bit like, it kind of tastes like pledge. But
I gave it a 1.5.
Ooh. That is very
only,
I mean,
because there is a finish, but that's it.
I'm giving it a 3.
Okay.
I don't dislike them.
I just thought there was a finish there, and that was all it did for me.
Keeping the price at the same score of a 4. That was weird. Nobody else heard that but us. Oh, but okay. I just hit my space bar and it made a weird noise.
It did this.
Boop. Sound like a wood block. My final score comes out to a 12 out of 20, which is weird because my last one was 11.5.
Am I doing my math wrong?
I don't know. What's your score on
9.5?
This?
9.5. Is that right?
Give me your scores again.
Daggone it. Okay. Nose.
Okay, we had to do some math there. Sorry.
Bless. Hey, two reviews in one. You're putting a lot of pressure on me, Perry.
But it's weird that my score came out higher than yours for batch two. But I think that like it doesn't drink great. But I think that like everything else around it is not that bad.
I don't like batch two at all.
I mean, it's weird because it scored higher, but I just prefer batch one overall.
Yeah. If I wanted just, another bottle of this I would get batch one.
This is the only time that I feel like our scoring system is so flawed that it doesn't even matter. But like the thing is, like, if I'm being consistent with price, like, that's going to skew things in the wrong direction.
It's at a good price though, to where you, at least in my sense, you can afford to grab one, and if you're disappointed, you can use it for blinds, you can use it for comparisons and all that.
It
doesn't break that $80 to $100 mark, so I'm okay with that. But man, that's all I'm saying.
No, I get it. I totally get it. I am happy that the way that we have experienced this is no different from, you know, where we are right now.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't have, I would have felt so much worse about it if I waited like in line to grab a bottle.
Oh my God. I would have hated myself.
Yeah. I'm just going to go back to this curly.
Oh, that's a good idea. But yeah, bluegrass hole on Instagram. Chris Havens, thanks for
the best handle.
Yes.
On all of,
thanks for helping
media.
Us get these and review them. We appreciate that. So,
dude, going back to the curly though, it's like night and day.
Well, shit.
Is that how you said it?
Well, shit. Is that our longest running joke?
I think so.
At least since
aside from our basement dwellers.
Oh yeah. Oh. Do you know what I want to revisit? Dystopia Chuck E. Cheese. First episode.
Whoa!
We were talking about Chuck E. Cheese, and like it was like Mad Max style.
Dude, I got to go back and listen to that. Yeah. I don't remember that super well.
Oh my God, that curly, dude.
Curly's great, man. Mm. So good. Okay, well, Tips and bits.
Tips and bits. I gotta recommend. This is YouTube related. It's okay. So I'm not the biggest fan of Barstool.
Good, because they suck.
not all of it. I'm telling you.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Have you ever listened to any of Caleb Presley's interviews?
No, I don't think I have, actually. Okay.
This is your style right here.
Okay.
I enjoy some of Barstool's stuff. It's sports and pop culture related, but this is called Sunday Conversation. And it's about, they're like 5-minute interviews with like rappers, wrestlers.
Oh,
and,
cool.
Yeah. And it's Caleb Presley. He's got this very like dry, awkward humor, and he doesn't do, it's not a serious conversation. I mean, he spins it in a way that just makes you laugh the whole time. And my favorite kicker is his co-host just sits on the side and eats ice cream. So
that's his whole shtick.
That's the he'll say like, "What do you think about this?" And he'll be mid eating ice cream, and he'll have to stop and be like, "Yeah, like do that." And it reminds me of us, because it's like, what if we were doing a serious conversation and you cut to me and I'm just eating a snack cake? But seriously, like, after we're done, I'm going to show you one of these. They're like 5-minute conversations on YouTube. It's Sunday Conversation with Caleb Presley. He does Randy Orton. He does rappers. He does like athletes. It's amazing.
That's awesome.
I'm telling you. And it's just this weird, serious / dry humor conversation that they have.
Right.
And you cannot tell me you will watch one of those and not laugh.
I mean, I think I will.
I know you will.
Yeah.
I'm saying the listener.
But before we get to my tips and bits, I want to mention that our poll results are astoundingly defiant. Yes has 0% of the votes. And no has 100% of the votes. So by asking people, are you influenced by products earning medals? It seems like folks do not give a crap if they go to a competition.
Makes sense.
And they earn something. I've got a few things that I want to recommend. Not a whole lot that I, you know, want to get too deep into. There's a musical artist that... Marie doesn't want me to talk about
Marie!
Them, apparently. That I've been listening to quite a bit. His name's Kamasi Washington. And I sent you one of his songs a while back, called Street Fighter Moss.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And it's kind of like, if there's ever such a thing as urban jazz, I think that's a good way of putting it.
100% agree.
But it's got this like backbeat to it that feels like hip hop and R&B, but he is so clearly influenced by jazz.
Yeah.
By you know, just old style saxophone playing, and it's so good. It's so good. And that one song, Street Fighter Moss, is so accessible. I feel like
I put it on one of my workout playlists. Like I have like a hip hop one, and then I have like a rock one. I put that on my
I listen playlist. To it a lot.
It's so good. It's really good.
I just think it's phenomenal. I'm gonna do something I've not ever really done before too.
Oh shit.
And I need a second to, because it's been a while since I've put this guy on my tips and bits list. Yeah, I do have a tips and bits list that I try to
Am I supposed to be doing that?
No, you don't have to. I do it because like it's just easier for me to like keep track of things. It's rare that I do anything that's like inspirational stories or uplifting or whatever, but I And I never watch ESPN, but for some reason, and I cannot remember exactly when it happened, but I caught this story of this guy called Chris Nikic, N-I-K-I-C.
Okay.
He is a 21-year-old athlete with Down syndrome. And he is amazing. He completed the Florida Ironman in 2020. Ever since then, he completed the Olympic triathlon, two more Ironman competitions, and he's now also a public speaker. And he's got this list of things that he wants to do before he's 23. As well. Some of these dates have passed, so I think that, you know, he might have crossed some of these goals, but like doing a children's book, doing the Hawaiian Ironman, doing the New York City Marathon.
Oh Lord.
Too. I mean, he is insanely inspirational. And he's got this thing called the 1% Better Challenge, which just is trying to, you know, and encourage people to accept,
right,
you know,
right,
differentiations in who we are. But it's got three different goals. Down syndrome awareness, accept the 1% Better Challenge, which he says, just for 30 days, do what I've been doing for 2 years in my journey to Ironman and help someone with special needs to do the same. And three is just like next steps. Buy a shirt for you. I know it's a little like trying to sell merch, but buy a shirt for you and the person you want to sponsor. Set a 30-day goal on what you want to achieve, and post your progress with your partner on social media to raise awareness. And I don't know, like it's just one of those things where, you know, I read about him and I see things about Chris, and I just like. Inspired by what he does. I mean, like, yeah. any time that, like, I, like, just even in the back of my mind, I'm like, I can't do that. Like, that's just too much. It's like, but other people have overcome so much more than I have to
so
accomplish
much more
goals.
Than both of us, yes.
Like, there's no reason for me to not, you know, set out to actually accomplish
right.
things.
No, I feel you.
And he's just one of those guys.
Yeah.
So go check out Chris. Chris Nikic. I think that's how it's pronounced. N-I-K-I-C. He's just awesome, man. Just really, really cool stuff. But anyway, I think that's it.
That's it.
I don't have any other tips and bits. I think Marie's going to serenade us.
Marie is giving her tips and bits.
She
right
is.
Now.
Yes. Bark at random people.
If you don't like somebody, bark at them.
Yell at them.
And don't do that.
I saw a video the other day of a dog that wasn't barking, he was more like yelling. And it was like he was going, it was so funny, man. It was so, I'll have to dig it up and find it for you before we get out of here.
Marie,
it's fine. You're a dog, they're a dog, we're all dogs. Woo!
Okay, I know. But I don't care. I'm doing it anyway.
I don't think we're going to be able to escape her barking.
All right.
So we may as well go ahead
Marie's
and finish
help
this
us
episode.
Finish this out right now. If you want to support the show, go to patreon.com/mybourbonpodcast for as little as $1 a month.
You're
you can
so
get
loud.
For as little as $1 a month, you can support the show. And at $5, you get all the uncut content, the extra shows, the weirdness that we did today. If you want to send us an email.
It's a really good day of podcasting, though.
If you want to send us a suggestion, a comment, or a message, or anything else, send an email to thisismybourbonshop@gmail.com. We got merch at bourbonshop.threadless.com, Whiskey Mutant merch at whiskeymutant.myshopify.com. If you want to leave a message on the barrel rings, 859-428-8253. That's a voicemail system. We'll play the voicemail and then we'll reply to you.
This lady was walking her dog. It's a big, like, greyhound. Or, no, it was a Great Dane. Sorry. And she just stood, like, in front of our house with her dog. Like, didn't move.
Just surveying the area.
I don't know. I think she was just literally looking at us like, what are you going to do about it?
What are you going to do about it? I know you got a camera on there.
Yeah. Anyway, sorry. That's what all the barking's about, apparently,
is
the Great Dane that's running around our neighborhood now. The animal.
All the social media, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube. This is My Bourbon Podcast, or at My Bourbon Pod. On YouTube, Perry goes live every Thursday night at 8. I try to catch him every month or so when I can. We'll see.
Are you working tonight?
No, but I got to get ready for my trip.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Got to do kid time tonight.
Yeah, you're right.
But yeah, check out Perry every Thursday night, 8 o'clock on YouTube. Check him out.
Dude, check me out.
Check him out.
Look at me.
Do it.
Have you looked at me yet?
Have you looked at me?
Check me. I'm losing weight right now.
Dude, you're doing a great job.
Thank you.
Very proud of you for that.
Thank you.
No joke. If you want to follow me at Whiskey Mutant on social media, and then just send your friend a message. Hey,
just let them know.
If they like whiskey or bourbon or pop culture, just send them a text. Say, hey, check out this is My Bourbon Podcast.
Well, here's the thing too. If you leave, I'm trying to get this to stick and it's not working.
Oh yeah, leave a review.
But if you leave a review, that helps us so much because it shoots us up in the search algorithm of whatever podcast app that you're listening through. And people can see us more easily. Yeah. So it's not only like a great way to, you know, share your interest with other people. It's also just, you know, it helps us out.
It helps
you
us
know?
Out.
The community, I feel like our community has just like spiked a lot recently. Like it's just, we've gotten a lot of positive feedback and thank you guys so much for doing that and being, you know, present and being aware and being willing to communicate with us as well.
Exactly.
Like that's the biggest thing is that, you know, I don't need like constant reassurance that everything I'm doing is good, but I mean it is kind of nice to hear every now and then that
really
y'all
is.
Like what we're doing. So anyway, were you done?
I don't think so.
Did I know?
Just tell people about us.
I've got no idea. But I think that does it for this week, guys. Again, just thank you so much for listening.
Yes. Tickets to the live show.
Get the live show tickets. Yes, absolutely. Book your hotel. Stay with us. It's
cheap. Hang out.
It's pretty cheap.
Yes.
Too. Yeah.
It really is.
Yeah.
Close to everything.
And that does it. Next week, I have no idea what's going on, but we'll be back for it.
We'll
regardless.
Be
here. We will be here. I hope you'll be here too.
Hopefully.
I'm pointing at my computer like it's like I hope my computer's
like,
gonna be
fuck
here.
You, I'm not going.
Yeah,
screw you, dude. I'm not gonna be here.
I'm gonna go jump off a cliff.
I'm gonna pour bourbon on myself.
I'm gonna go meet Pete Samuels.
Pete, it'll be okay. Pete's gonna take care of
Trust Pete.
Pete is Pete. Let's go.
All right, that does it for this week. Guys, thank you again for listening. We love you guys so much. We'll see you really, really, really soon, like in a couple hours for me, because I'm going to be doing this live stream.
Live.
Until then.
Pete is Pete.
Until then, I'm Perry.
I'm Eric.
And this is My Bourbon Podcast.